Amen. Praise God. I want to read to you from the book of James, the 5th chapter. James chapter number 5. Begin reading with verse number 16. Found it, say amen. I'll wait on the rest of you then. James chapter 5, verse number 16. Confess your faults one to another and pray one for another that ye may be healed. Everybody say healed. Effectual fervent prayer of a righteous man. Everybody say a righteous man. Availeth much. Elijah was a man subject to like passions as we are, and he prayed earnestly that it might not rain, and it rained not on the earth by the space of 3 years and 6 months. He prayed again, and the earth, or the heaven gave rain, and the earth brought forth her fruit. Amen. Notice verse number 16, the effectual fervent prayer of a righteous man availeth much. It availeth much. Amen. I really had no intentions of discussing this or preaching on the subject, but this morning in prayer I felt very, very strong that the Lord was leading me in this direction. So I want to talk to you today about dominion praying. Dominion praying. Amen. And I believe the Holy Ghost wants to move here this morning. Well, praise God, that's about 30% of you. It's going to happen. We all are going to have to get involved here. Praise God. Amen. How many really want the Lord to touch you and to challenge you today? God wants to help some of you in this place this morning. Amen. Let's clap our hands and lift our voice one more time. Magnify the Lord. Praise the name of God.
Praise God.
Praise God. Amen. You may be seated. Praise God. I'm not here today to discuss or to preach on the subject of healing. However, I am a firm believer that God heals. Well, praise God. Now, see, we got a problem here already. I'm not a Bible teacher, I'm an evangelist. And evangelists are real funny creatures. They're weird folks. And we kind of used to people responding. And so I'm going to need you to respond here today. Amen. And here's how it works. If I say something you believe, you just say amen. It's real simple. Praise God. Amen. And James is dealing with a particular subject that perhaps we may have overlooked the degree of which in what he's trying to say. Amen. I don't think that he's just discussing divine healing in the text. However, that is mentioned in a very important part of the text. But he begins by talking about we are to confess our faults one to another. Now, I will tell you that you might ought to be careful who you confess your faults to, lest they confess your faults to somebody else. Amen. And if you're going to confess your faults, make sure you confess it to somebody that's trustworthy and so on and so forth. Amen. Then he said that you may be healed. The effectual fervent prayer of a righteous man availeth much. Elijah was a man subject to like passions as we are. Prayed earnestly. It might not rain. Didn't rain for 3.5 years. He prays again and it rains. The heavens open up. I will tell you that the reason why this text is very important to me is I was preaching in church, and this congregation had drifted to a great degree from the doctrine of separation, and they had become more what we would call charismatic, and in a negative sense. And we they're preaching. And the pastor kept talking to me about how much they prayed and the hours that they spent in prayer. And I knew that they did. And it kind of bothered me that this congregation and this pastor could have spent so much time in prayer, but yet be so deceived. and so disillusioned by the fact that he thought because they prayed, it was a signal or a right to be disobedient to the word of God. I don't care how spiritual you become, you never get so spiritual that you can bypass the word of God. Doesn't matter. Amen. And so I went home and I thought, now how in the world can somebody pray like these people confess they pray and yet be so mixed up and messed up in their understanding of the scripture? And this text came alive to me. I want you to understand that he said, James said, it is the effectual fervent prayer of a righteous man that availeth much. Not just the effectual fervent prayer of a man that avails much, but of a righteous man that avails much. I don't know how you feel about praying, but I refuse just to spend time marking time and just going through Pentecostal cliches and absolutely nothing happening. If I'm going to pray, I expect God to answer my prayer. If I'm going to spend time with God, I'm going to do more than just go through some little prayer or something and mention a few things that we've learned. But if I'm going to pray about somebody being delivered, I expect them to be delivered. If I'm going to pray about deliverance, I'm believing God to loose deliverance. If I'm praying for somebody to be healed, I believe that God's going to heal. Well, praise God. We don't want to just spend time to be spending time and marking time and nothing happening. I believe that when the church prays, it becomes the most powerful force on the face of the earth. I believe that when the congregation begins to lift their voice in prayer, a righteous congregation that begins to pray, I believe that hell begins to tremble because it recognizes the potential of power that is witnessed there. You better look up. You better back up. Something's about to happen when the church begins to pray. Oh, hallelujah. Amen, amen, amen. James said it is the effectual fervent prayer of a righteous man that availeth much. He said Elijah prayed earnestly. You begin to see that these people that prayed didn't pray in some monotone, boring ritual format, but there was feeling when they prayed. There was something witnessed when they prayed. Amen. The word earnestly actually derives from a word which means prayer. And if you read it the way the original would say, it just simply would say that Elijah prayed in prayer that it might not rain. That's the first thing I thought. Now, how in the world do you pray in prayer? And what all does it mean? And I did a little word study on the text and found out that it actually, the word earnestly meaning prayer, but not just the rhetoric of words, but rather a position or a place designed by God for man to come to and to petition him and to fellowship with him and to have knowledge of him. Amen. The first place, if you go backwards in retrospect, the first place you find is the temple. When Jesus walked in that day, he said, it is written, all nations know that my house shall be called a house of prayer. But you've turned it into a den of thieves. Amen. I believe it is the will of God and the purpose of God for our churches to be known as a place of prayer. Not a peanut brittle factory, not a pizza making crew. But I believe when you get to talking about the apostolic church in your city, they ought to recognize, hey, those folks know how to touch God. When you walk into their sanctuary, when you walk into their building, you sense the spirit of prayer that's there. You feel the abode of something holy and sanctimonious that's in that place. Oh, praise God. Amen. Thank God for music and choirs and oratory. But that's not what our churches should be known for. They ought to be known as a place that knows how to pray a hole in the sky, that knows how to get a hold of God and get down to business with him in prayer. Oh, somebody shout hallelujah. Amen. 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 Now, I want you to recognize that when James says he prayed earnestly, that he moved into a place or a position with God to pray. Amen. He again lets us know the key statement. It is the effectual, fervent prayer of a righteous man. The word righteous does not deal with that which is imputed to man by God, but rather a man who has a desire to be morally right with God and in right standing with God. Amen. Amen. I'm telling you that the greatest need we have is for there to be a desire in our hearts. I've got to be right with God. Doesn't matter what somebody next to me's doing. Doesn't matter what the church across town's doing. Doesn't matter what some of the ministry is doing. If I'm going to make it, I've got to have an overwhelming desire. I've got to be right with God. Doesn't matter who moves right or left. I've got to be right with God. Jesus said, if you thirst and hunger after righteousness, you shall be filled. I tell you what the United Pentecostal Church needs. It needs a baptism of a desire. I've got to be right with God. I don't live like this because they hand me a manual or an affirmation statement. I live like this because I believe it's right with God. Oh, praise God. Hallelujah. Amen. Amen, amen, amen. Well, I do it because somebody's looking over me and making me do it. You're a double-barrel hypocrite. Amen. Well, I only do it because somebody forces me to do it. Well, the moment the pressure's off, you're going to revert back to what you really are. You better start getting a hold of God and saying, God, give me something in my soul. Give me something in my heart that says, doesn't matter who backslides, doesn't matter who compromises, doesn't matter who backs up. I've got to stay in the right position with God, because if my prayer is going to avail something, I've got to be in righteousness. Hallelujah. Amen. It deals with the fact that a position of prayer, a place of prayer. I don't have the time to go into all of it. You trace it all the way back when you get home. It also deals with the fact that these Hebrew men, when they went to pray in the Old Testament, they always or most likely prayed by water. Because before they prayed, they would wash their hands, symbolizing to God that they wanted to be morally right with God. That's why Paul picked it up when he wrote to Timothy. He said, I would to everywhere that men lift up holy hands unto God. Men that who are in right position with God. I thank God for every woman. I thank God for every lady in the United Pentecost Church. I thank God for everyone that knows how to pray. But I'm telling you, what we need is a revival of men that know how to pray. Amen. Amen. Now, you follow all this back. It goes all the way back to the garden. The first place that God instituted where man would come and fellowship with him and commune with him and talk with him. Amen. Still here. In that place and in that position, Adam in right standing with God, God told Adam, said, in this place, I give you dominion. I give you authority and power over all of creation. I've given it to you. And as long as Adam was in right standing with God, he exercised his authority and his dominion over creation. But the moment that Adam fell into sin, he forfeited. That's the reason why in the temptation when Satan came to Jesus, he said, all of this power I can give you that has been handed to me, delivered to me. I personally believe that when Adam fell in the garden, that all of the authority and the dominion that God had given him, he transferred it to Satan, who becomes known as the prince or the ruler of the earth, which is Adam's rightful position. Well, praise God. Amen. Isn't it amazing that throughout the entirety of the Old Testament, there is absolutely no demon possession as far as manifested and being cast out. It's as though that the spirit world is silent to a degree. But the moment that Jesus Christ comes through the baptism, steps into the synagogue, all of a sudden he begins to upset the church service. All he did is read from the text. All he did is read the scripture. But the devils began to cry out because they said, we recognize that this is the Holy One sent from God. And what they really hated was the fact that when Jesus stepped on the scene, he stepped into it, not having forfeited, not having given up his position. He possessed the power and the authority that God had given Adam in the beginning. My God, have mercy. That's the reason why he said, I refuse to give it up. And when Satan recognized him, he said, if thou be the Son of God, turn these stones into bread. Let me tell you something. You may have talked the first Adam out of his authority. You may have got him to transfer his dominion. But I'm not giving you mine, buddy. I've come to destroy the works of the devil. Oh, hallelujah. Hallelujah. Three times he tries to get him to succumb to his temptation. But three times Jesus keeps echoing back. It is written, it is written, it is said. Not giving it to you. I've got a job to do. And as long as I stay in my right position with God, I've got power over you, buddy. You don't control me. You don't have dominion over me. You don't have authority over me. I've come to tear your kingdom down. I've come to let you know that the kingdom of God is here. Hallelujah. That's the reason why in the 14th chapter of St. John, and I'll come back to it in just a moment, Jesus lights the sticks of the clothes, and he turns to his disciples and he says, I will not talk much with you hereafter, for the prince or the ruler of this world cometh, but he doesn't have power over me. We don't have anything in common. We don't settle on even ground. We despise one another. I've not forfeited my power. I've not forfeited my authority. He doesn't have power over me. I have power over him. Hallelujah. Now, I hate to disappoint some of you, but when you got the Holy Ghost, you got more than just a ticket to glory. And you got more than just some emotional high. And you got more than a little glossolalia. You got more than just the fact God cleaning you up and helping your problems and solving your problems and putting your marriage back together and taking drugs out of you and all that stuff. And all that's great and powerful. We believe God's going to do it this week. Amen. But when the writer pins the words in Titus, he talks about being renewed and regenerated. Talks about being regenerated by the baptism of water and renewed by the Holy Ghost. It's my personal belief that when Adam rebelled in the garden, that in the parable of Jesus in the Good Samaritan, that he is depicting and showing the dilemma of humanity. When he said that the man fell among thieves and was left half dead. That Adam, when he sinned, he died spiritually. He is now alive in the flesh. He has now quickened his conscience of knowing good and evil and to experience it. Amen. He is alive physically and carnally, but he is spiritually dead. But Jesus looked at Nicodemus and he said, I got news for you, buddy. You can't even get into the kingdom until you've been born again of the water and of the Spirit. I'm telling you, when you are baptized in the name of the Lord, and the only way to be baptized is in the name of the Lord, and when you were filled with the baptism of the Holy Ghost, you got more than glossolalia and a ticket out of here. That which was dead in you, that which was dormant in you, has now been quickened by the power of the Holy Ghost. I I wonder what Jesus meant when he said, "Behold, I give you power over all the power of the enemy, and nothing, and nothing, and nothing shall by any means harm you." If you boys could see what I'm about to do for you, if you could really see what's about to happen, you would understand I'm about to renew something. I'm about to rebirth something. It's more than just tongues. I believe that when you are born again of the water and the Spirit, that God is moving you back into the original creative form. You are reverting back with him to a place of right position. And James understood one fact. He said, "I recognize what sin does to a believer. When sin enters the picture, it causes the believer to move out of his right position. It causes him to forfeit and to yield up his authority and his power. So therefore, if you've sinned, you need to start confessing and repenting and getting it right. Because God gave you the Holy Ghost, yes, but the Holy Ghost is power." Now, he said Elijah was a man of subject to like passions as we are. Now, I want you to look at something. Did you know that when Elijah prayed, that in his prayer, God gave him dominion over the elements? Oh, it's going to get weird here in a second. He said, "Elijah, I'm going to give you power to shut up the heavens and to open them at my word." And James is trying to tell the church, you got the same stuff. You got the same thing. Don't let sin forfeit it. My God, have mercy. Now, see, I've watched people pray and I've heard them, "Oh God, oh God, oh God, oh God, oh God. Help me, Jesus, help me, Jesus, help me, Jesus. Move, 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 move. Oh God, oh God, oh God, oh God. Bless the church tonight, God. Touch my pastor, touch the church. Oh God, oh God. Save my backslid kids. Oh God, oh God, oh God, oh God. Oh God, oh God, oh God, oh God, oh God. Oh God, oh God, oh God, oh God. Oh, move, 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 move. Praise God, praise God, praise God. Now, what are some of those other words I heard them say? Oh, hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. Oh, thank you, Jesus, thank you, Jesus, thank you. My God, I've only prayed 20 minutes. Oh, praise God. Glory to God in the highest. Oh, God, save the world, 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 save the world. Oh, God, oh, God, oh, God. Touch the choir member, touch all the hypocrites in the church, God. Touch every reprobate, God. Oh, God, oh, God, oh, God, oh, God, oh, God, oh, God, oh, God. Oh God, oh God, oh God. I think you missed something somewhere. I think you missed it by a million miles if you ask me. I'm telling you that when a man or a woman that has been born again of the water and the Spirit and is in right standing with God, when they move into that place of prayer, God is telling them, in this place, in this position, I have given you dominion and I have given you authority and I have given you power. I didn't leave you here just to be idle. If all it is a ticket to glory, the moment you talked in tongues, I could have zapped you through the portals. But I didn't. I need to leave somebody here that can have authority. I done lost half of you. Because all you know about living for God is coming to church on Sunday night. And the choir hyping you up. And the preacher preaching to you a few standards. And that's all you know about God. You need a revelation today of who you are. You're not some Walmart blue light special. The devil trembles when you move into that place. He knows you have power over him.
I got news for you. The prince of your city is not the most powerful thing there is in it. You are. I lost half of you right there. Because you're going to sit back and make an excuse. And you're going to do like the book of Proverbs says, there's a lion in the street, therefore I'm not going out. My God, go kill it. Go take it down. Lord, teach us to pray. All right. Our Father which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done. The word kingdom there does not denote just a territory. It's not to be confused with an actual kingdom, but the right or authority to rule over a kingdom. It actually means royal power or kingship, rule or dominion. And Jesus said, when you start praying, thy kingdom come. Let the king come. Let his authority come. Let his dominion come. Because where the word of a king is, there is power. I feel my help coming now. Amen. Praise God. Let me tell you something. Go home and study the writing of Hebrews, the 11th chapter. When it says, for by faith they understood that the worlds were framed. Plural, worlds framed. Doesn't mean cosmos. It means, well, we get the word eons or aeons. Amen. It actually means ages or dispensations. The word frame means to complete or to finish. What the writer of Hebrews is trying to say is, I'm fixing to show you some folks that finished their age, that did what God called them to do. And the only thing they had to go on is a word from God. I'm going to tell somebody today, you don't need confirmation after confirmation after confirmation and affirmation after affirmation. It shouldn't be that every Sunday night God has to single you out and keep talking to you and talking to you and talking to you. Some of these folks only got spoke to one time. Some of them would go years and years without God ever speaking back. But they had one thing in common. They were in the kingdom of God. God had spoken. God had decreed. I'm telling you, there's power in the word of God. There's power in the spoken word of Almighty God. All it takes is for this dispensation to be finished or framed is for people to understand, I've got a word from the king. I'm operating in his authority. And in his power. Oh, I know some of you are highly disappointed because you'd rather sit around and complain and whine and make excuses. You'd rather glory in the fact that you're defeated and knocked down. You'd rather glory in your poverty and in your peril. You'd rather glory in the fact that you can make excuse why nothing more is happening because, well, it's the devil, it's the devil, it's the devil, it's the devil. It's spirits. Oh, my God. They just attack us and attack us. Welcome to the church. When you enlisted, didn't you know you enlisted in the army? It's a battlefield, brother. This is a war to the finish. There is no spiritual retirement in the kingdom of God. I'm telling you what the Holy Ghost is trying to bring us into is for us to understand when I move you into that place, when you start praying in the Holy Ghost, brother, in that place, I'm giving you dominion, I am giving you authority, and I'm giving you power. Open your mouth and say it. I got to use a little illustration. Now, I don't want anybody to misunderstand what I'm about to say. If you know me any way at all, you understand I despise dead church. I hate it. Let's have a revival or a riot. But let's have something. In the beginning, God created, and the earth was without form and void, and darkness covered the face of the deep. And the Spirit of the Lord moved upon the face of the waters. Two things it takes to finish creation. It takes the Spirit moving and the Word of God. In any successful apostolic church service, it takes two things. It takes the Spirit and the Word. But Elder Wilson, the Bible says, and the Spirit of the Lord moved upon the face of the deep. In one translation it says, and the Spirit of God brooded or hovered over unfinished creation. Or I heard, I think Brother Wilson, somebody said the other day, over unfulfilled potential. Everything that was needed to finish it was hovering above it. It was upon it. Woo, did you feel it on us today? Ooh, it's on us. And the only thing we knew to do with it is to get out in the aisle and do the disco duck or chicken walk or something. Oh my God. I can't take much more of this power. If they don't let up, I'm going to explode. I don't think God just wanted to put his power on you for you to blow up in a Pentecostal church service somewhere. I think there's more to the authority and the power of God than you leave saying, woo, son, I got a blessing tonight. My God, it got on me. I couldn't contain myself. Man, I just going crazy. My God, what power. How many people were healed? How many people got delivered? How many people were filled with the Holy Ghost? But boy, I sure got it on me. Got news for you. All of a sudden, the Bible says, and God said. And brother, when God said, it's like all of that power and creative power above it started being channeled and focused now. We're fixing to go to work now. Something's been said. It's been directed. Something has declared it now. I hope to God we have more than a hovering of the Spirit at camp meeting this year, and more than just a little something. I pray to God that somewhere along the way we'll wake up and understand all this power, all this authority has been given to us to take dominion. My God. I'm running too close. Jesus. God wants to shake the city this week. All these apostolics in one city. The devil ought to be having a nervous breakdown about it right now. But you know what? He ain't worried. He's not the least bit threatened as long as he knows. They ain't going to move into that place. They're going to dress nice, look nice, and try to come impress everybody. They're going to talk about prayer, but they're not going to do it. They're going to talk about apostolic revival, but never witness it. Don't worry about them. Besides that, I got a lot of them condemned. A lot of them's over here in rebellion and sin. Don't even worry about it. Long as they live in the carnal realm of man, don't worry about it. Ain't no power, no threat to us. But if they ever start moving into that place, then we better start worrying. I want to preach to somebody today. You need to quit complaining about it. And go to taking authority over it. You need to quit sitting there thinking, oh my God, what am I going to do? It ought to be the devil in the spirit world saying, oh my God, what are we going to do? That Randy Fraley is getting into the spirit of prayer. I got to preach this today. My God. He's not just saying words, but he's given his vocal cords to the Spirit. For likewise, the Spirit also helpeth. Helpeth. In other words, you've got to be doing something. It'll come help if you're doing something, but it's not going to do it all. It helpeth. Why do you let that Spirit keep pushing and pushing and pushing? Why do you let it control and take down and destroy? Help me now, Holy Ghost. Amen. Why do you allow it to intimidate and keep knocking down? Why don't you say, enough is enough is enough is enough. I put up with this. All I'm going to put up with it. I'm going to God in prayer. And I'm telling you, likewise the Spirit also helpeth our infirmities. For when we pray as we ought, the Spirit itself maketh intercession with groanings which cannot be uttered. And he that searcheth the heart knoweth what is the mind of the Spirit, because he maketh intercession for the saints according to the will of God. And all of a sudden, something starts happening. And that tongue starts, just the tongue of edification. And all of a sudden, something moves on you. It's like Adam back in creation. It's like Adam standing with his feet planted in that right place. It's like God saying, there it is. Take dominion. Take authority. I've given you power over it. Don't back up. Don't give in. Don't move to the right, to the left. Go straight ahead and say it. I wonder how this camp meeting would go if all of a sudden on this first morning session we'd make up our mind. We're not staying over here where we're beat up. We're going where the Holy Ghost calls us. We're going to pray in the Holy Ghost. We're going to sing in the Holy Ghost. We're going to preach in the Holy Ghost. Sounds pretty charismatic to me. Oh, shut up. You've been letting the charismatics intimidate you and confuse you. And just because they got the baby don't mean she had it. I need to preach about that this week. Remind me to preach about the baby. Just remind me. It was in a revival service a few years ago. Now, you won't talk about locked up. I need to introduce to you Okmulgee, Oklahoma. I could tell you about medicine men and chants and witchcraft and stupid stuff. This is a revival of this evangelist. This evangelist was a weird joker. He'd preach a while and he got locked up. He'd just stop dead still. He'd say, we ain't going any further till we have moved God. And I don't mind telling you, I knew him and I knew them. And I said, my God, we in for a long service tonight. Be bad. And so he's up there. He just stopped. He wouldn't preach. He wouldn't say another word. He just stopped and just watch. So I'm watching him. I'm watching them. I thought, you know what? Forget him. Forget them. I'm just going to talk to God. So I started worshiping and praying, talking in tongues. And the more I prayed, the better I got the feeling. And all of a sudden, it's just like, you ever been drunk in the Holy Ghost? I just started getting drunk. Just, man, I'm feeling pretty good. See, here's something you need to learn. You can't whoop a drunk man. You can't whip him. You can take a tuba for and hit a drunk man. Blood's running, and he looks at you and says, if I ever wake up and found out you hit me, I just might be mad. He's got so much alcohol going through his bloodstream, you can kill him and he doesn't feel a thing. See, some of you are trying to fight your problem sober. That's why you feel everything. You're trying to fight it out of your intellect. You're trying to use reason and logic and trying to calculate, move, and be a little manipulative. That's what you have to do if you can't depend on the Spirit. Instead of trusting God supply your needs, you got to lie and cheat. Anyway, so we're on the platform, and I'm just getting soused. I'm just feeling pretty good. And all of a sudden, this voice explodes in my head and said, "Who art thou, O Spirit, that you would exalt yourself against the living God?" And boy, when it said it, it's like electricity went through me. And then I noticed that this tongue I was speaking in changed from this nice little dainty tongue to this. And I recognized, my God, I'm talking to that Spirit in tongues. Oh, I'm sorry for all you intellectual high IQ folks that you don't believe this stuff. Just go ahead and live life where you want to live it. It kept coming on me. Boom. Boom. And the evangelist picked up on it. He said, "Church, if you have ever prayed, you better start praying right now. Because your pastor is battling with the spirit that has bound this church for years. If he loses, he'll lose his mind and leave here with a nervous breakdown. If he wins, you're fixing to have a revival." And brother, they went to praying. My brother Jeff was assisting me at the time there. And brother, they went to praying. He told me, he said, "Brother Morgan, it looked like you were sword fighting something across the platform." He said, "It's going back and forth. Back and forth." The only thing I remember from that point on was, "My God, we knocked this thing down. Let's get victory, complete victory." And brother, I let out a Comanche war cry. But tell you something, all of you in boot camp and all of you AWOL folks, so you don't understand fox and trench fighting. You don't understand foxholes. You go ahead and pray your little pious 30-minute prayer. I'm telling you, when you're in the struggle of your life, brother, when hell's broke loose all around you, when the spirit world says, "I'm taking you down," something desperate gets a hold of you that says, "I ain't praying on this now. Lay me down to sleep. I pray the Lord my soul to keep stuff now." Brother, it's a battle to the finish. Brother, when you look at that child and you know hell's about to kill it and it's trying to destroy it, you'll forget this mimsy-pamsy praying, brother. You'll start praying in the Holy Ghost. "Help me, Holy Ghost. I pray now, Holy Ghost." It's got to be broken. You've got to break the chains. You've got to break the fetters. Brother, when you drive through your city and you see all those folks bound by immorality and you see the world going to hell, you'll forget praying your little prayer, "God save the lost." You'll start remembering faces. You'll start seeing the last drug addict. You'll remember the last alcoholic. And you'll start praying, "I bind you, you demon of alcohol. Loose them. Loose them. And let them go." And we prayed. When that thing broke, power of God hit me so strong, it literally knocked me across the platform. But when I hit on the other side, it looked like somebody took a machine gun and mowed everybody down the church. They were draping across the pews, falling between the pews, talking in tongues, magnifying God. Hang on a second. There's a girl sitting in the back, first-time visitor. She's in a wheelchair, been in a bad car wreck, died. They revived her and all, paralyzed from her neck down. Elder Wilson, nobody laid their hands on that girl. Nobody went back and quoted to her scripture about healing. But when that thing broke, pow, girl come leaping up out of that wheelchair. Nobody took her by the hand. Nobody said, say Jesus. When I got up off the platform and looked, she was already in the front. The church still hadn't seen her. They're still magnifying God, drunk and lost in the Holy Ghost. She had her eyes about that big around. She was weeping, saying, preacher, I'm walking. My God, I'm walking. And then she went to talking in tongues. I'm telling you, the church has power, and the church has authority, and the church has dominion. My God, why don't we use it? I want to provoke somebody to a fight today. I pray to God some saint, preacher, evangelist, prophet, or whatever, you'd wake up and say, that's enough. That's enough. I'm going to the enemy's camp, and I'm going to take back what he stole from me. Somebody's fixing to step into that place right now. Boom. Somebody's fixing to say, that's it. That's it. I'm fixing to pray in the Holy Ghost. Woo! Come on, loose your tongue. Come on. Pray in the Holy Ghost right now. Let something flow through you.